Hello everybody, let's go ahead and talk about another application of calculus, which is kinematics. Now, kinematics is just the study of motion, and what we'll see is that there is a very direct connection between how you approach kinematics and how we approach functions. So let's take a look at those two. Here's our functions column, and here's our kinematics column. And remember that when we dealt with functions, of course, that was y is equal to f of x, our horizontal axis was x, and our vertical axis was y. Now, in kinematics, though, we're dealing with movement, and movement is going to change depending upon a different parameter, which is going to be t, and t, of course, is going to be time. And then we're going to have the s of t, which is going to be the amount of displacement from the origin. Okay, so s of t is going to be our displacement function. Now, when we talk about in our functions, the average rate of change, basically we took a look at the change in f over the change in x over our particular interval on the domain. Now notice it's exactly the same thing for kinematics, in that if we wanted to go ahead and talk about the average rate of change, we looked at a different current, we looked at a particular interval of time, and we took a look at the change of the displacement over the change in time. So notice, the only differences here is the fact that our variables are different. It's going to be the same thing even when it comes to the instantaneous rate of change, when we took the limit as delta x approaches zero of our average rate of change. If we take a look at the kinematic situation, it's exactly the same. Now, when we go ahead and talk about how we represent it, the instantaneous rate of change, we use the f prime of x notation. Now, when we go ahead and take a look at the instantaneous rate of change in the kinematic sense, of course, we're talking about s prime of t. Now, the thing about s prime of t, which is the change of the displacement over the change in time, really what we're talking about is velocity. So v of t, or the velocity, is going to be equal to s prime of t, or the first derivative of the displacement. Now, when we looked at f double prime of x, that was again just taking the first derivative of the first derivative, we can also go ahead and do the same thing with the velocity function, and taking the derivative of the velocity function, which looks like that, will give us the change in the velocity over the change in time, which in this case is going to be the acceleration. So acceleration can be found by taking the first derivative of the velocity function or the second derivative of the displacement function. So notice there's a lot of similarities mathematically. It's just that when it comes to the application revolving kinematics, we need to go ahead and make sure that we speak of s prime of t as the velocity function and the v prime of t as the acceleration function. Now, also what's going to happen is that we're going to see that we're going to need to go from two dimensions to one dimensions. Because when we're talking about linear motion, we're talking about a particle that is just moving either left or right. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at a situation that we can see how we can transfer information from a two-dimensional graph to a one-dimensional linear motion graph. So let's say, for example, we have s of t, or our displacement function, being equal to t squared minus 2t for 0 less than or equal to t is less than or equal to 3. So in other words, this displacement is only going to be taking place for 3 seconds, when it starts at t is equal to 0, and when it ends, which is t is equal to 3. Now, if we go ahead and take a look at a two-dimensional situation, of course, we can go ahead and plot this, and it's going to look like a parabola. Now, the thing is we need to go ahead and change this two-dimensional image to a one-dimensional image, which looks like this. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at some very fundamental differences between the graphs. Of course, the horizontal axis is t, and the vertical axis is s of t. When you talk about the one-dimensional graph, the horizontal axis is actually going to be s of t, and the value of t is going to be associated with the points that are actually plotted on the graph. Now, of course, when we talked about a linear motion graph, I talked about the particle just moving left and right. I'm going to go ahead and just change this just very slightly so that we can go ahead and see how the particle is moving as time increases. So notice that when we go ahead and talk about our displacement function in the two-dimensional case, if we go ahead and plot this point, that's 0, 0, this is 1, negative 1, 2, 0, and 3, 3. Now, if we go ahead and transfer that information here, when t is equal to 0, s of t is going to be equal to 0 as well. So notice that when s at t is equal to 0, s of t is equal to 0 as well. Now, when we move to 1 second, the displacement is now negative 1. So here's the displacement of negative 1 at 1 second. And then when t equals 2, the displacement is 0. So when t is equal to 2, the displacement is back at 0. And when t is equal to 3, the displacement now is at 3. So notice that when t is equal to 3, the displacement now is 3. So you just have to go ahead and make that simple adjustment to go ahead and transfer the information from a two-dimensional graph to a one-dimensional graph. And notice the other thing that I've included as well is the direction of the path. So these little arrows are telling me exactly which direction the particle is moving. Okay, now let's go ahead and take a look also at making sure that we understand the interpretation of the various functions that we have. Because when we talked about functions in our functional analysis, we talked about the first, second derivative and how it is interpreted as the behavior of the original function itself. We also want to go ahead and be able to do the same thing with our kinematic displacement function. So I'm going to go ahead and say, for example, that if we have a function here, and if that function is equal to 0, greater than 0, or less than 0, how do we go about interpreting the behavior of the graph? So in our general case, when we talk about f of x, if we had f of x being equal to 0, then of course we were dealing with an x-intercept. If f of x was greater than 0, then that means that the point was actually above the x-axis, and if it was less than 0, then it's below the x-axis. Now, if I was to go ahead and take a look at this, I think it's very clear as to how I go ahead and interpret that, assuming that this was f of x and this was x. Now, we want to go ahead and take a look at how this actually applies to our displacement function. What does it mean when the s of t is equal to 0? Well, when s of t is equal to 0, then that means that the point is at the origin. Now, when s of t is greater than 0, then that means that it has to be to the right of the origin. And when s of t is less than 0, then that means that the point has to be to the left of the origin. So notice in the two-dimensional case, we're talking about the relationship from the distance from the x-axis, whereas with regards to the kinematic s of t displacement function, we're looking at the relationship and placement with respect to the origin. Now, f prime of x, again, remember, dealt with stationary as well as stationary points, as well as increasing or decreasing. So when f prime of x was equal to 0, we had a stationary point. When it was greater than 0, the function was increasing. And when it was less than 0, the function was decreasing. So when we go ahead and take a look at the velocity now, which is the first derivative of our displacement function, notice that when the velocity is equal to 0, nicely enough, it's also stationary. That's the same vocabulary that we use. Now, if the velocity was greater than 0, what's actually happening is that the displacement of the particle is actually moving to the right. Now, if v of t was less than 0, then that means that it's moving to the left. So if we go ahead and take a look here, f prime of x is equal to 0 when t is equal to 1, or when x is equal to 1, and therefore we have a stationary point there. And notice that here, when the velocity is equal to negative, or when t is equal to negative 1, the velocity also is going to be 0. Now, if we go ahead and just take a look at the increasing part, this f prime of x is going to be increasing for all values of x that are greater than 1 to 3. And then if we go ahead and take a look at when this particle is moving to the right, sure enough, it's from t is equal to 1 to t is equal to 3. And then of course we can also go ahead and do the same logic, apply the same logic to the decreasing situation. Now, f double prime of x, again remember, dealt with inflection as well as concavity. So if we have f double prime of x being equal to 0, that's a possible inflection point. If f double prime of x is greater than 0, then f of x is concave up. F double prime of x is less than 0, then f of x is going to be concave down. Now, this one tends to be a little bit more tricky because you don't necessarily see how this is being applied specifically on the graph itself, but the acceleration, or v prime of t, when it is equal to 0, we have a possible maximum or minimum velocity of the particle. Now, if a of t was greater than 0, then what's happening is that the particle is being pushed to the right. So it's being pushed to the right. Moving, that doesn't mean that it actually is moving in that direction, but what's happening is that the acceleration force is pushing the particle to the right. In the same respect, when we go ahead and take a look at the acceleration being less than 0, then the particle is then being pushed to the left. It doesn't mean that it's moving to the left, it means that it's being pushed to the left. Okay, so let's go ahead and wrap up here. So again, when we go ahead and talk about the applications of calculus, we're going to see that there's a very direct relationship between the functional and kinematic interpretation, calculus interpretation. And then what we need to do is we need to be able to go from two-dimensional to one-dimensional linear motion graphs, which is what we did here. And then it's also going to be important for us to be able to recognize how s of t, v of t, and a of t, how their different signs will give different interpretations of the behavior of the particle. Now, what we're going to have to do as well is we're going to have to take a look at what the difference is between velocity and speed. And if you can think about that and hopefully come out with a solution, we'll discuss that in class the next time that we meet. Okay, so see you then. Bye-bye.